There were three manufacturers in India, but they were making other layer, which meant two fire processes. First you fire the body, which is bulk master firing. Then you fire the glaze with it, sometimes that will bond, and if something falls, the glaze comes out and it's a very porous body. In Victory China, you fire the body in glaze at one time, so the bonding is much better. Even if the chip, glaze chips, the porosity is less than 0.5%, so it doesn't absorb water. This was a very new technology in the world, 3 years old, very difficult to get at that time. It changed the face of the sanitaryware market and brand things that was born. The first breakthrough came with Jawaharlal Nehru and statistician P.C. Mahalanobis, who emphasized on more flexible economic policies involving both public and private sector based on direct state intervention. It was a beginning, but the wait was long. Our Honorable Prime Minister P.V. Narasimha Rao initiated major reforms that ushered in liberalization in the country in 1991 and changed it all. This year, Hindu Air Sanitaryware production turns 50 October next month. I started small, hands on every aspect of the business, down to the shop floor, molding clay to marketing, managing capital, and always planning ahead. Bahadurgarh plant was manufacturing 60 pieces a day or 1.5 lakh pieces annually. Today, the same plant produces 18 lakh pieces per annum. It's now one of the many matrix units we have set up in India. At this point, I would like to relate an incident which will give you an understanding of how restrictive an industrial scenario was in the mid-60s. After 3 years of efficient and improved capacity building, we marginally crossed the license capacity, which is now known as the license per metrage. And guess what? When the production report was filed with the central government, we immediately received a notice asking for an explanation how the unit managed to cross the defined capacity levels, which was 5,400 tons at that time, just marginally crossed it by about 3 or 4 tons. I think you will agree with me that improvement in capacity building should be lauded, but the government did not see it as a positive for the system. It was not an achievement, but a rule being broken. All these are gone by, but I need to tell you what we had to go through. The post-liberalization days definitely helped the industry. Urbanization in India began to move at a faster pace, and with it came the urgent requirement of residential and commercial buildings. This in turn brought about new government policies and the national housing policy formulation thus envisaged housing for all. By the end of the 9th plan period was one of the big steps. Today, we operate in a highly complex, interlinked, fast-shifting marketplace. Asia, though not yet the world's largest economy, has increasingly become the fulcrum of change for global business, and the world has fully recognized the potential of India. I feel extremely gratified to see this growing trend. It is an opportunity, not just for business growth, but for employment and lifestyle changes as well. But to capitalize on this opportunity, it is important to understand the underlying social issues linked with industry, sanitation and plumbing. According to 2011 census data, 47% of total Indian households have poor sanitation facilities. 69% of rural and 18% of urban households still do not enjoy basic sanitation access. Tomorrow, when you will be building your own home and go sanitary shopping, will you concern yourself with the unseen complex fabric that lies beneath the beautiful bath product you just purchased? Perhaps not. Till clogged drains, broken pipes, or a leaking faucet needs your attention. I too probably would not have if not being in the sanitary business. But business is not about all the selling for me. I believe that without a collective mutually shared desire to improve and interlink industries, not only the sanitary industry will be impacted, but a long-standing social cause will continue to be ignored. Truth be told, I feel saddened that the sanitation plumbing landscape has hardly changed in terms of perception policies, opportunities and awareness from the time I began my business. The pure neglect, archaic rules and disinterest that I witnessed on this issue is very concerning. Plumbing is a long, prolonged history which has made the contemporary world the reality. And plumbers play a very important role in the society, safeguarding the community from many harmful events that bad planning can cause is intimately related to public health and one of the key building blocks in building the advancement of human civilization. Will you choose to live in a place that lacks proper sewage sanitation system? Will you not worry about your health? Will you not think twice about the water flowing from the tap and wondering if it's contaminated sewage water? The SARS epidemic, which you all must have heard, of 2003 is one of the recent case studies directly linked to that plumbing. Amoy Gardens in Hong Kong, a private residential estate providing living space to approximately 20,000 Hong Kong residents, was where it all started. Initial epidemiologic investigations prompted the hypothesis that environmental factors may have been involved in the transmission of the infectious agent, and with further study, it was found that the interaction of ventilation plumbing aided the transmission of the infectious agent. During earlier 19th century, outbreaks of deadly disease were commonplace in New York City and London. Cholera, diarrhea, measles, and malaria plagued residents due to large influx of people and a lack of proper sanitary services. In 1832, London sewer system was yet to reach Soho, and the London government decided to dump waste into the River Thames. This action contaminated the water supply, leading to the cholera outbreak. The case was similar in New York too, when physician John Snow's study of the cholera outbreak greatly pointed towards contaminated water. As the saying goes, desperate situations bring forth heroes, and the jury emerged. Edwin Chadwick and Dr. John Snow were two notable advocates for proper sanitation and water supply systems. They urged the case of public health legislation that would remove open sewers and prevent pollution of groundwater. They learned and made amendments. Yes, in the past decade, the sanitation conditions have improved a lot in India, but it is not enough. If statistics are to be believed, even today, preventable diseases related to water and sanitation claim the lives of about 31 lakh people per year, most of them children less than 5 years old, a mind-boggling 110 lakh people, two-thirds of them in Asia, and 42% of the population in sub-Saharan Africa lack access to improved water sources, out of which at least 260 crore people lack access to improved sanitation. Over half of them live in China and India. This is from the UN report. The United Nations declared 2005 to 2015 International Decade for Action, Water for Life, setting a world agenda that focuses on increased attention to water-related issues. It is an enormous goal that provides purpose nearly for 9.7 crore people annually to have access to drinking water services, and nearly 13.8 crore access to sanitation services through 2015. The initiative of extraordinary importance in a world where access to safe drinking water supply and sanitation is still a monumental task to achieve. However, optimism is the way forward. Improving rate of literacy along with the increasing disposable income of consumers in India, the sanitary market in developing countries like India and China have been growing tremendously in the last five, six years. The Indian sanitary market today is pegged at 2,000 crore and growing annually at about 15-16%, holds promise for both the industry and provides opportunity to tackle the issue of plumbing and structure sanitation network. If the India sanitary market forecast and opportunity 2017 is to be believed, in the coming years, India will witness huge improvements in sanitation level. In a way, it has to, as frontrunners aim to become the second largest consumer sanitary products in the Asia-Pacific region. Without better sanitation network, the road ahead will not right now. The rising level of middle class, increased disposable income, better education, government initiatives and boom in the real estate sector will add to this growth momentum in the coming years. This scenario is already visible with consumer attitudes toward bathroom changing from a big being a monument place to being a place to unwind, relax and refresh. As a company, we have not only been instrumental in offering the larger product basket at various price points, targeting all strata of the consumer demographics, but simultaneously taking the cause of plumbing as a skill set to be acknowledged. Training plumbers create job opportunities as well as to create awareness about sanitation is crucial to us. It's important to understand that social causes cannot be fulfilled in isolation. Social cause is for the society needs to be understood and embraced by all industry, policy makers and the common man. The 50% people worldwide having access to drinking water through pipe system, the 30% having draining facilities to public sewers, WHO 2012 report. The scenario definitely can change if we focus on the encouraging future growth part for the industry. Making a difference lies on the shoulders of all. Today it is me and tomorrow it is yours. If you have the gumption, you too can stand here one day and share the contributions you and the industry have made for a better lifestyle for all. As a corporation, we have been in the Indian market for more than half a century now. Years of experience have taught us to be perceptive towards tomorrow's needs, and that means many minds working together. At HSIM, we have a vibrant corporate culture, young management graduates like you working alongside senior executives, keeping pace with the market dynamics and creating scope for all-round progress. As I close, I would like to say, whichever vocation you choose to work, you need to remember growth has to be inclusive and you cannot ignore the social component of business. Thank you.